This is the V1-45 flame licker, flame eater, or vacuum engine. It's made out of anodized aluminum or aluminium for all of those outside of the U.S. and a few pieces of stainless here and there. The cylinder is brass, and it appears the piston is brass. Flywheel is brass. This is an adjustment for the flame position. I have found that there's a bit too much of this wick exposed. I wrapped some aluminum foil around that and tied it with a piece of thread, and I put a piece of thread around the wick to keep it from fanning out so much, to hold it together. The position, the end of this wick, and I have it trimmed flush. You want that to be right in the middle of this intake port. And generally, when this is running, that flame has been right about there. One thing you'll notice, any place there is a hole or a cavity, there's a slot. It appears this was either laser cut or water jet cut. Once it starts cutting, it comes across, enters, cuts the hole, comes back out, the same slot goes on, cuts the next hole, comes out, goes on. When I got this thing was backfiring and spitting and popping and carrying on. And I tried about 15, 20 different positions. The best one I have found is this reed valve will be completely closed when the crankshaft is 30 degrees before bottom dead center. And due to the cam design, it will automatically be fully open before the piston gets all the way up, and it will exhaust what is above the piston. The way this works, this is a very thin piece of brass shim stock. You have a fire on here. As the piston travels downward, it's sucking air and the flame into the cylinder cavity. When the cam gets to 30 degrees before bottom dead center, the reed valve closes the port. The piston's still going downward, so it sucks a vacuum on this and holds that tight. The contents of that hot flame that was drawn in there, that will cool off. It drops the pressure above the piston, creates a vacuum. Atmospheric pressure is higher than what's above the piston, pushes the piston upward. The port opens. Momentum of the flywheel continues to drive the piston upward, and the exhaust gases come out, and the whole thing repeats itself. One way to test this to make sure that you're getting a tight seal on your reed valve is to push up on this, close that port, and pull on the piston. And when you get right down there, you'll feel it get tight. If it's not drawing tight, put just a little bit of oil behind that piece of brass. And I put about three or four drops, 3-in-1 oil or Singer sewing machine oil, a real light oil, on top of the piston, give it a few spins. The piston seems to be a very good fit in this. I hold that up, and right there, I can feel it drawing a vacuum on that reed valve. The cam is over here on the right side of the crankshaft, and the cam follower has a roller bearing on it. I put a little bit of oil on there just to reduce any wear, hopefully. And I put a little oil here on the bottom end of the connecting rod and up on the wrist pin of the piston as well. This is one of the screws for the crankshaft. And just to the right of that is the screw for the cam. And you can take a Allen wrench and stick it down in there so you can adjust the timing for that cam. That's about all there is to this. There's a fan over here. This model appeared to be warehouse stock for a while here in the U.S., and the band that was on here became gummy and was deteriorated, so I replaced it with an old rubber band. This is just a piece of sheet metal that's been cut out, and then they've put a little bit of a pitch in those blades. Unfortunately, about 2/3 of that fan is blocked out by this mounting bracket. But it does blow a little bit of air across that cylinder and will keep the engine running a little bit longer, not a whole lot. You will see in the listings for all of these engines the term Stirling. They put Stirling and flame licker and all different things in there just so all the model engines will appear when someone searches for any one of them. This is not a Stirling engine. This is a vacuum engine. I have also seen it written that this engine will run for an hour or two on this tank of fuel. It will not. You'll be lucky to get 10 minutes out of this. This is a rather large flame, and this whole engine gets hot by the time this is empty. If you get a 10-minute run out of this, you'll be doing quite well. I get a fire on that thing, and I just keep flipping this thing until this cylinder gets hot. That can take quite a while, 5 minutes, 6 minutes. This will not run until this cylinder gets hot. Then once it's running, you'll find everything gets hot. This plate and everything will start getting quite warm. When the tank is empty, you'll start to notice that the wick is glowing red on places. Blow it out, turn it over here, snuff out those burning embers, save your wick, let the whole thing cool off before you refill the tank and run it again. You want all of this to cool off. You do have some bits and pieces of nylon or plastic in here. And if this thing gets too hot, that could be detrimental for those. I have quit using rubbing alcohol. It burns way too dirty. I'm currently using denatured alcohol. You can get that in the paint store. It's used for thinning shellac and different products. Methanol, methyl ethyl alcohol would work fine. Make sure you put that cap on the tank before you light this. You wouldn't want to get a spark or something, go over there and have that blow back at you. Now it's just a process of continuously cranking this. I'm checking this to make sure I'm pulling the vacuum. It is. And you can hear it attempting to run. You'll be cranking on this for quite some time. And this will bounce back and forth on that cam. It'll be trying to run in either direction. When this starts, you want to make sure that it's running clockwise. If it's not, stop it, start it again. Okay, I've been doing this for a few minutes. I reach back here on the cylinder, and I can feel that it's warming up. We're getting very close to running. Keep trying to find the sweet spot for that fire. I may have this fire just a little bit too small. Let's spread that out a little bit. The size of the fire, I've got it quite a bit smaller than when the wick was exposed all the way back to here. How close the wick is to the intake port, it all has an effect. And the temperature of the cylinder, I reach back here and feel this. This is quite hot now, and it's running pretty well. With the smaller fire, this outside frame and that is not heating up as bad. This is a typical speed for this engine. Blow that out. Put a little more fuel in here. It takes quite a bit of fuel just to get this to a point where it will run. Now that this is hot, we put some more fuel in the tank. You can relight this. It'll start. one does not coast like the Stirling engine does. What do I think of this engine? It's made well. Once you get it up to temperature and get it running, it runs consistently, it runs well. You may have to play around with the timing and that to get this reed valve to close at the correct time. If it's popping and spitting and backfiring on you, it's out of time. So it is something that you may have to put a little bit of effort into, play around, learn the engine. There's a few cosmetic differences between this and the one that's currently shown on the Banggood website. This is anodized aluminum, so is this. I've seen mentioned that the cylinder may be stainless. I'm not sure about that. But there are a few cosmetic differences, and if anything, the one that's currently shown on the Banggood website may have a few improvements. It's a fun engine. It's a very good demonstration engine. Not everybody has one of these. It hasn't run for a few minutes. Let's see if it'll start again. Comparison of the two engines, the Flame Licker and the Stirling, quite large models.